This is one of the largest public embezzlement cases in state history. This is a sprawling conspiracy.
Ooh, I got some juicy stuff for y'all today. So I was planning on doing a story on Brett Favre, but then that video turned into two videos, and then I just really felt like I should do this video first. So today, we are going to talk about the embezzlement scheme going on with the state of Mississippi. Shad White has described this as the biggest embezzlement scheme over the past two decades, which is as long as we've had our records. $77 million in welfare funds are missing. Missing, y'all. $77 million. So where did it go? And how did it happen? We are about to see. Welcome to part one of the Mississippi Embezzlement Series. But first, good morning. My name is Jessica, and welcome to my channel. It would be so amazing if you could like and subscribe. It would really help me grow my channel. But thank you so much for clicking and giving me a chance today. So the major players in this part of the story are Nancy New, her son Zach, and they run MCEC. We'll get back into them in a minute. Ann McGrew, who was her accountant. John Davis, who was the director of the Mississippi Department of Human Services. Latimer Smith and Brett Dibiase, who was a wrestler. So the first player we're going to talk about today is Miss Nancy New. Nancy New is the owner and director of the Mississippi Community Education Center, as well as New Learning Incorporated. She was very, very well respected in the education field. In 1992, she files her first paperwork with the state of Mississippi to make MCEC a nonprofit organization. And she also files paperwork for a private business, New Learning Resources. According to the tax documents, MCEC's mission is for the promotion, improvement, and expansion of community education through training, seminars, consulting services, and technical assistance. In 1997, she founds the New Summit School in Jackson, Mississippi. Over the years, she has grown her private school district to include North New Summit School in Greenwood, Mississippi, South New Summit School in Hattiesburg, Mississippi, Oxford University Academy in Oxford, Mississippi, Spectrum Academy in Jackson, Mississippi, as well as an online school called New Learning Resources Online. Later, in a bid filed with the state, she describes the nonprofit MCEC as the nonprofit supporter of the New Learning School District. So in 2013, Families First of Mississippi was first advertised. That's when the website first popped up. And that website is now deleted. Formal documents for the organization won't be filed for a few years. Families First for Mississippi, remember that name. I'm probably gonna have to do a whole nother video on that, probably like a fifth video, because there's just so much, and it goes along with the story, but it really doesn't have anything to do with the arrest or the missing money. So we're just gonna sidebar Families First of Mississippi, and just know that Families First of Mississippi was the organization that MCEC and then Family Resource Center of North Mississippi, they were funneling the welfare funds through. So the next player is John Davis. And John Davis was the former director of the Mississippi Department of Human Services, which is responsible for handing out contracts for the welfare funds as the temporary assistance for needy family funds. And so he was overseeing all this. And John Davis is a career employee for MDHS, the Mississippi Department of Human Services. He worked there for 28 years. On January the 11th, 2016, he was appointed director of the department by the governor, Governor Phil Bryant. So on July the 1st, 2016, that is when fiscal year 2017 begins for the state government. In the previous fiscal year, MCEC was only awarded $1.1 million in funding. However, over the whole next fiscal year, MCEC will be awarded $11.4 million, 10 times as much. Also, in fiscal year 2016, the department only approved 1.4% of applicants for temporary assistance for needy families. 1.4%. It was something crazy like 176 families out of 11,000 or something like that. So in fiscal year 2016, So in fiscal year 2016, the department only approves 1.4% of applicants for the temporary assistance for needy families. Over the next 2 years, they'll roughly approve 1/4 of the applicants. But the overall case study continues to drop. The program is serving less than 7% of Mississippi families living in poverty. Yet they shell out millions to MCEC and FRC, as well as their little friends they got going on. So our next player is going to be Brett Dibiase. So Brett Dibiase was part of the Florida Championship Wrestling in 2010. If you're like me and you don't really know anything about wrestling, this is a development league for the World Wrestling Entertainment to help people, like, you know, minor league baseball. So he's playing minor league WWE, and he suffered from some injuries, and he never really made it to the big time. He's the son of the Million Dollar Man, if you know who that is. I don't. I do know now. Because he's also been funneling millions of dollars out of our welfare system. But anyway, so Brett Dibiase, his biggest pro wrestling moment was in 2013 when he pretended to be an upset fan and he like goes in and he tackles the ref who's reffing the WWE match. Actually, until I read this, I didn't realize how fake wrestling is and I was kind of amazed. But it was between Randy Orton and John Cena and apparently it was a big thing. February 16, 2017, Davis hires Brett Dibiase, former pro wrestler, as a deputy administrator for MDHS at $95,000 a year salary. And what his qualifications are, nobody really knows. But if you look at his LinkedIn says he was the director of transformational change. How about that? MDHS spokesman Danny Blanton says that Dibiase was hired at the sole discretion of John Davis. So on April 21st, 2017, the Clarion Ledger puts out the following article. MDHS confirms most new applicants rejected for welfare. So MDHS were under fire. Of 11,700 people who actually applied for the benefits for temporary and needy assistance, temporary needy families, only 167 were approved. That is 1.42%, and it is the lowest approval rate that year in the whole nation. So July the 1st, 2017, fiscal year 2018 begins. Funds from MDHS to MCEC, so from the state to the nonprofit, they would double this year, reaching $22.4 million. So before Davis took office, it was $1.1 million, and then it was $11.4 million, and now it's $22.4 million. Out of $135 million in federal aid from the Temporary and Needy Families Program in 2018, Mississippi spent just 5% or $7.3 million on direct cash assistance to poor families. In the same year, Human Services gave $44 million to MCEC and FRC to run Families First of North Mississippi. So the Family Resource Center, this is a whole separate organization from Ms. New, but she pretty much doled out money in the north part of the state and Ms. New did in the south part of the state, is my understanding. Just if they needed money, those were the two that it was coming from. So as of October of 2022, no arrests have been made from FRC, but they are listed in a civil suit by the state wanting their money back. So September 15th, 2017, 7 months later, Brett Dibiase leaves MDHS. 2 months later, November 7th, 2017, Family First of Mississippi's announced they will be partnering with a nonprofit run by the Dibiase family. Families First posted, and Ted Dibiase Jr. says this, "We will also work hand-in-hand through faith-based strategies to unite churches, businesses, and organizations throughout the state in efforts to collaboratively help families dependent on government programs transition to become more productive and sustainable members of society." is a match made in heaven, he says. But this site, too, has been deleted. December the 8th, 2017. New files paperwork with the state to formally incorporate Families First for Mississippi as a nonprofit organization. So here enters our next player, Latimer Smith. On January 18th, 2018, Latimer Smith was hired as MDHS staff officer. In July of 2018, Brett's brother, Ted Jr., appeared on Paul Gallo's show with John Davis promoting Families First. And so here enters two more players, Zach New, Nancy's son, who is the assistant executive director of MCEC, and Ann McGrew. Ann McGrew is MCEC's accountant. So on September the 20th, 2018, Nancy New, her son, and Ann McGrew began conspiring to move more than $2 million in MCEC funds to the news. December the 12th, 2018, Dibiase signs a $48,000 contract with MDHS to inform, update, and educate MDHS staff and partners in identifying opioid abuse, and he's also supposed to teach 24 other training sessions about opioids. Nobody's really sure what his qualifications were, but during that time, Mr. Dibiase spent his time at a place called Rise in Malibu, which is a luxury drug rehab place that boasts of these amazing views of the oceans. So Latimer Smith, then MDHS staff officer, he is actually listed as the contact on his paperwork at Rise in Malibu. So January the 2nd, 2019, Brett Favre, Nancy New, Zach New, Jacob Van Landingham, and John Davis meet at Favre's house to discuss a deal. Favre and Van Landingham will be discussed more in a later video, but Van Landingham, you'll hear his name again, he is the head of Provocus. I don't know if I'm saying that right, but it's a medical technology company that Favre invested in. So January 18th, 2019, prosecutors say Zachary New makes an illegal transfer of $750,000 of MCEC's funds to personally invest into this medical technology company that's located in Florida. This is the first illegal transfer of several, and it used funds to help the poorest of the poor people in Mississippi. So Jacob Black, in mid-2019, he was John Davis's deputy, and Jacob Black and other employees gathered information on Brett Dibiase and how he was being paid, and how it was possibly double-dipping into these other accounts that his brother Ted Dibiase was running. So although Black himself was very involved and instrumental in creating many of these grants, he is also the person responsible for reporting the scheme and getting the auditor in there and having all of this found out. So Bryant reported to Shad White, the state auditor, on June 21st, 2019. 2 weeks later, on July the 8th, Davis announces that he's retiring from MDHS. He says, "I now have the opportunity to focus on my family at home and pursue a position outside of state government. The Lord has blessed me tremendously, and I will count my time at MDHS as one of the greatest." But he really didn't retire. He was really forced out by the governor, because the governor knew what was going on, and he knew all this stuff was about to go down. So on July the 31st, 2019, Davis's resignation is official. Just like that, 5 weeks after the investigation starts, Davis is gone. So 2 weeks later, August the 14th, 2019, Latimer Smith also leaves his position at MDHS. October the 7th, 2019, Zach New made the final illegal transfer to the Florida Medical Company. He is accused of transferring a total of $2.15 million to two Florida companies, which is Provocus and Presol MD, with the participation of his mother, Miss Nancy New. This is separate from the more than $2 million that prosecutors say that they transferred the funds to themselves. So on February the 4th, 2020, Shad White arrests Nancy New, Zach New, Brett Dibiase, John Davis, Ann McGrew, and Latimer Smith, and indicted them in Hinds County Circuit Court. So they were indicted on February the 4th, 2020, and they were arrested on February the 5th, 2020. And the auditor's office issued a press release, even though the case involved millions of dollars in federal money. The U.S. Attorney General for the state, Mike Hurst, was not aware aware of the arrest until they happened. So on February the 6th, 2020, a judge orders that MCEC's bank accounts to be frozen. So on February the 9th, 2020, White announces that he's meeting with the FBI to discuss the investigation. So far he has not brought the Fed in as of then. So on February the 9th, 2020, Shad White meets with federal investigators, the FBI, to discuss the investigation. He says, "We moved quickly and quietly in the auditor's office to put a stop to the DHS scheme before any more money was taken. And now it is time to use every investigative resource available to uncover all the fraud that remains." Despite them moving quickly, the news nonprofit still received $9.4 million from the time that Shad White began the investigation to the day they were arrested. Their last check came only 2 days before the arrest on February 4th, 2020. So the investigation began in July of 2019, and according to Shad's White office, MDHS was informed before December of 2019. And so since they knew that they were under investigation, they could have stopped distributing funds to Miss News nonprofit, but they didn't. So between December of 2019, when MDHS was informed about the investigation, and February the 4th, 2020, MDHS still shelled out $1.4 million to Miss News nonprofit. Once MDHS learned about the investigation, it could have very easily stopped all the payments due to suspicion of fraud, but they didn't do that. So 2 days before that they were arrested, they were paid over $19,000 from the state. So, $77 million in welfare funds is missing. Where is the money? What was it used for? You will have to check out part two of this video to see. Have y'all been following this story? What do you think should happen to these six people who were indicted? Leave me a comment in the section down below. As always, thank you for watching. Bye!